Good morning, everyone. Good to see you today. Glad you're with us. It's a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord. Thanks for joining us, whether you're in person or online today. Let's stand together if you're here, and let's sing.
Good morning, church. It's good to see you guys this morning. Glad that you could be with us today. I do have a few announcements for you. We have officially launched a new TCC app, and so we'd love for you to go and download that in any of your app stores that you guys have, whether it's Android or Apple. You can do all sorts of things on there. Of course, you can read the Bible. We have our sermon notes in there, so you can fill in the blanks there, take notes. If you're watching online, we are glad you guys are with us. You can also watch a live stream through the app if you'd like to do that. Prayer requests, you can even fill out your connection card on there. And so several things you can give, all that, and there'll be more options that are coming, so we'd love for you to download that, use that to its capabilities. Also, coming up here this weekend on Friday and Saturday is the IF Gathering for our women, July 15th and 16th. Friday will be from 6 to 9:30 p.m., and then Saturday will be from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. A great opportunity, all ages to come and to worship, to fellowship together. Tickets are $10, and you have to register online, so you can go to tongiecc.org for more information about that. Tomorrow should begin our construction, or deconstruction, I guess, first, of the parking lot. And so hopefully that will get started next week. But we do want to make you guys aware that there may be times when you're not able to get in like you normally would. So if you're going to come up and visit the office, just be sure you call first so that we can tell you where to go. Next Sunday, don't know exactly how that will look. And so we may have a couple of parking attendants out just to direct you where it's safe to go park and where it's clear. So, but just be flexible here the next few weeks. Also, we have a great opportunity that was brought to us by a Christian church up in Leavenworth. They have been parking cars at the county fair over here at the fairgrounds for nearly 50 years. And they said, listen, we just can't do that anymore. And we'd like to hand it off to another church. It's a great fundraiser. They've used the money for all sorts of different things. Some of it has gone towards outside activities. Some of it, some things inside the church. But it'd be a great opportunity for us to raise some money for some different ministries, whether it's here at the church or with the amount of money we raise, we could even supply the Backpack Buddies with just that if we wanted to do that. So lots of opportunities there, but what we need are volunteers. They're going to train us this summer, and so we need 6 volunteers every night of the fair. So it's from 5 p.m. to about 9 p.m., and simply just parking cars. A couple of people to take money as they come in the gates, and then the rest will be directing traffic. And so we'd love to have some of you who have maybe helped before in parking here could come and help there. Some of the staff's going to be there just to train ourselves to understand how this all works. Next year, we'll need more volunteers, of course, because since we're helping them this year. They're going to split the proceeds with us this year since we're going out to help them. But if you're interested in helping, please come and talk to me or call the office and let us know, and we'll get you on the list. We've already had a couple that came up this morning. So just a great opportunity for us to not only be out in the community, but also to raise some funds for whatever outreach or ministries within the church we might want to use that for. So those are some things that are coming up in the life of the church. Don't forget, Blood Drive is at the end of this month. You can sign up at our website for that as well. Again, your connection card, you can fill out the hard copy if you want. If you have the app, you can fill it out on the app, and we'll receive that as well. I do have one other thing I wanted to mention, to read to you. After our Saturday 150th celebration, we had some leftover food, and we were able to take that over to Vintage Park, and they sent us a couple of nice thank you notes. The first one is from the actual residents there, and so they all kind of signed their name. It just says, dear friends, thank you for the cookies and ice cream. We really enjoyed them. It was so nice of you to share. They must not have told them that we gave them some of the other food too. They appreciated the cookies and ice cream, but that's okay. The other thank you note is from the actual folks that work there, and they simply said, dear Christian Church, thank you so much for the donation of food and the treats. Your gift came at a time of need and is greatly appreciated. Happy anniversary. So they may not have told them that the meat came from us, but that's okay. Just wanted to pass that along to you guys. Thank you for those of you who helped participate in that weekend's festivities. We all had a great time. Why don't you stand this morning and turn to those around you and greet each other this morning.
love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through. Jesus, there's nothing impossible. Well, I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see an empty tomb. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. Stand against the power of our God. So when I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And when I fight, it belongs to you. And when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Playing the same song I'm playing. Yeah, we changed that one. Yeah, everybody sing whatever you want this morning. It's We did practice, I promise. Hey, I think we know that one. It's not in the key of H.
Jesus, your name is power. Thank you.
I got this one, Jeremy. I got it right. I'd like to read from 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 26. For I received from the Lord that which also was delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Eat this. This is my body, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Whenever I was around 6 years old, I attended church with Mom and noticed they were passing a plate of bread around and another plate that had some juice on it. And I got kind of excited. And it got to us, and unfortunately she stopped me from taking either one of them, and I thought it was just because she didn't want to mess. Wasn't until much later in life that I would learn the significance and embrace the gift of communion that we all have. The Lord's Supper is significant to all of us for multiple reasons. In the scripture that I just read, Paul writes how the Lord's Supper is given to us by God himself as a means to bring unity in the body of Christ. Also, we observe the Lord's Supper. Whenever we observe the Lord's Supper, we recognize that the table looks in three directions: past, present, and future. Past we call commemoration. The Lord's Supper refers to the last Passover meal Jesus had with his disciples here on earth. At that time, Jesus took the bread and the cup and passed them around, signifying his body would be broken and the shedding of his blood would usher in the new covenant. And we'll learn in Jeremiah 31:31, it says, "The day is coming, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah." Therefore, the Lord's Supper makes us remember that Jesus, what he did on the cross. That's why it says, "Do this in remembrance of me," in both verses 24 and 25. Sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross. We are to remember how he was flogged and beaten and that his blood was shed to take away our sin. Present, communion. The Lord's Supper speaks of the present and how we have fellowship with the living Christ. We have communion with him now because our sins are forgiven. We do not have to wait for heaven to have fellowship with God. We can have communion now. Not only do we have communion with God, but we can have communion with each other, with other believers. This brings unity out of division, which is exactly what was happening in Corinth when Paul wrote this letter. The future, commitment. We are to continually observe the Lord's Supper till he comes. Therefore, this table also looks ahead to Christ's return. It reminds us that Jesus is victorious and he will set up his kingdom here on earth. We are to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again in the future. It also signifies the destruction of Satan when Jesus will return in victory. We won't be taking communion at that point. We'll be at the banquet table and Satan will be defeated. The Lord's Supper keeps us focused on the cross. It draws us into fellowship with God and with the body of Christ. It gives us the hope of the resurrection, the promise of victory over Satan and sin, and the truth of heaven. Heavenly Father, as we come to the table, help us to reflect on the past, the present, and the future. And help us focus on your incredible love and faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
We kicked off this sermon series looking at the symbols in Jeremiah last week. We didn't actually look at a particular symbol. We just focused in on Jeremiah's call from this would-be priest to a preaching prophet. Now we're going to start looking at some of the major symbols throughout the book. And of course, I joked last week we're going to spend 52 weeks in the book because there are 52 chapters. Although that does work out perfectly, we're not going to stay in Jeremiah for an entire year. It would be interesting to try and do that. Maybe for me. Maybe it wouldn't be quite as interesting for you. I don't know. But today we're going to be in Jeremiah 13, and we're going to look at the symbol of a belt. And what I want to do this morning is read the text to you first. So this is going to be Jeremiah 13. If you have your Bible, something with your Bible on it, pull it out, or you can follow along on the screen. But this is the NIV version, so I chose that here to read. Sometimes it'll be the NLT or NIV throughout the sermon, but I want to just read the passage so you get a full view of what's happening here. So this is Jeremiah 13, verses 1 through 11. This is what the Lord said to me. Go and buy a linen belt and put it round your waist, but do not let it touch water. So I bought a belt, as the Lord directed, and put it round my waist. Then the word of the Lord came to me a second time. Take the belt you bought and are wearing round your waist and go now to Perith and hide it there in a crevice in the rocks. So I went and hid it at Perith as the Lord told me. Many days later, the Lord said to me, go now to Perith and get the belt I told you to hide there. So I went to Perith and dug up the belt and took it from the place where I had hidden it. But now it was ruined and completely useless. Then the word of the Lord came to me. This is what the Lord says. In the same way, I will ruin the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem. These wicked people who refuse to listen to my words, who follow the stubbornness of their hearts and go after other gods to serve and worship them, will be like this belt, completely useless. For as a belt is bound round a man's waist, so I bound the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah to me, declares the Lord, to be my people for my renown and praise and honor. But they have not listened. Let's pray. Father, we come before you, and as we dive into this text, I ask that you help it to come alive for us so that we can see the image, we can understand what you were trying to do through Jeremiah to this nation of Judah, and how we can then take this story, and I know that we can, but take this story and apply it to our lives today. Lord, we admit, we understand completely, we confess whatever, we are not Judah, we understand that, but we are the church, and we know there is a connection here. We know that we need to learn from the past. So help us to do that today. Help me to preach this with clarity so that we can understand what your word is saying here. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We've all heard the stories. Some of us may have even lived out the truth that seatbelts save lives, right? Year after year, we hear about it. We read about somebody's testimony of how a seatbelt saved their life. Law enforcement for many years has had that slogan, that seatbelts save lives. Some of them also, now it's click it or ticket, right? And I won't make you raise your hands if you ever got a ticket for not having your seatbelt on. But in Jeremiah's day, they had no real use for seatbelts, of course, but a linen belt tied around the waist was helpful just in keeping your clothing tight to your body as you would work and as you would move around throughout the day. It didn't save your life to wear a belt, but it might save you some embarrassment. Because if you put that belt around your robe, in your tunic, and a strong wind came through, you know, it would keep things where they should be, okay? And so I'm just being honest here with you. It helps save you from some embarrassment. The belt would keep things where they were meant to be. You may notice that some of the translations describe it a little differently. Instead of a belt, it's a linen loincloth. Some translations will even say a girdle, which is kind of strange. But what God had Jeremiah go purchase was essentially a belt. He told him, I want you to go buy a belt. Don't put it in water. Don't put it in water. That would have probably made it softer and more comfortable, but he says, don't do that. Now, we don't know how long he wore the belt. We have no clue. But some amount of time passed, and then God told him, okay, now take the belt off and go hide it. The NIV says he went to Pereth. That's a town near the Euphrates River. That's 300 miles away. So that's a long trip just to go hide a belt. Jeremiah did it, though. He may not have understood why, but he obeyed. He goes, he hides the belt in the crevice of a rock. Many days later, we don't know how many, the Hebrew seems to probably indicate a long time has passed. God tells him, go back and get the belt. So he dug it up, he found the belt, but because it was a linen belt, it was ruined and completely useless. Now, as it turns out, this wasn't just God trying to test Jeremiah's obedience. This is one of Jeremiah's action sermons. He is preaching a sermon with the very actions that he is doing here in the text. And so the rotten belt was a description of how God was going to rot away the pride of Judah if they continued to follow their own desires and just ignore God. They would become like Jeremiah's belt, rotten and ruined. The NLT describes Judah like this in Jeremiah 13:10. Therefore, they will become like this loincloth, good for nothing. Judah's going to be good for nothing, just a worn-out, rotten belt. The belt image is a warning to Judah. Unfortunately, they choose not to listen, and they actually do become useless to God, good for nothing. And although this warning was written directly to them, not directly to us, we should be smart enough to learn from the mistakes of the past, because you are the belt. We are the belt. God's pretty clear about that. In Jeremiah 13:11, he says, as a loincloth clings to a man's waist, so I created Judah and Israel to cling to me, says the Lord. They were to be my people, my pride, my glory and honor to my name. In the Old Testament, the nation of Israel was the chosen people of God. They should have never split into two kingdoms where Israel was in the north and Judah was in the south. That should have never happened. The nation of Israel was God's chosen people through whom the Messiah would come. God created that nation to cling to him like a belt clings to your waist. They were created to cling to God. And in the New Testament, God establishes the church. And that is now the people of God. That's very clear. Galatians 6:16, it says, may God's peace and mercy be upon all who live by this principle. They are the new people of God. We, the church, we are the new people of God. So it is not a stretch for us to apply this text in Jeremiah to our situation today. In the Old Testament, God longed for his people to cling to him like a belt. I mean, he has Jeremiah live out this action sermon just to show the people that they are a belt. They were created to hold tightly to him. Now you are the belt. Now we are the new people of God. Do you cling to him? Do you hold tight to God like a belt holds tightly to our clothing? God brought the nation of Israel close to himself. He brings us close to himself as well. Imagine God tightening up that belt just one more notch to make sure that it is close. It is close to the body, that it's secure. He wants you to cling to him through all of your life, all the life that you live, the ups and downs of life, but sadly, not everyone does that. Judah didn't. They defiled themselves with idol worship and became good for nothing, the text says. Now, I find it ironic that God told Jeremiah not to let the belt touch water. Because one of the biggest issues that we face in the church in America is the watering down of the gospel. The truth of Scripture is watered down to make it more palatable, to fit certain ideologies. If Jeremiah had placed that belt in water, it would have fit much, much better around his body. It would have fit and formed better to his body. And that's what some people do in the church with the Scripture. We water it down so that it fits and forms to whatever we believe, to whatever they believe, instead of what Scripture actually says. And we, honestly, we shouldn't be surprised at that. We shouldn't be taken off guard by that, because Paul told Timothy years ago that this would happen in 2 Timothy 2:3. He says, for a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They'll follow their own desires. And what do they do? Well, they look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They're going to reject the truth and chase after myth. It happened then. It happens now. The question you have to ask yourself is, if you are the belt, what kind of belt are you? Are you the kind of belt that is strong and sturdy, tight, secure? Or would you see yourself more like the belt from this story? Jeremiah 13:7, the NLT, it says the belt was rotting and falling apart. The NIV says the belt was ruined and completely useless. I hope that you don't see yourself as ruined and completely useless. You're not. I want you to hear that today. No matter where you're at in your life, as a follower of Christ or as somebody trying to follow Christ and learning more about Christ, you are not useless. You're not. And if you feel that way, then maybe you need to repent. Maybe you need to turn from some of the sin that you've been struggling with. That's what Jeremiah was trying to get Judah to do. He tried to get them to repent and to cling to the Lord. That's why he's using this image of a belt. In Jeremiah 4, he talks about this idea of repentance. Verse 1, he says, O Israel, says the Lord, if you wanted to return to me, you could. You could throw away your detestable idols and stray away no more. Then when you swear by my name, saying, as surely as the Lord lives, you could do so with truth and justice and righteousness. Then you would be a blessing to the nations of the world, and all the people would come and praise my name. They could have repented. They could have done that and clung to the Lord, but they didn't. You got the same choice. If you're feeling like this rotten belt from the story, repent. Turn back to God. It's not too late. It wasn't too late for the nation of Judah, but it eventually got too late for them. Instead of clinging to the Lord, they were clinging to Baal, and they were worshiping idols. Because they had become this useless, rotten belt, God chose to rot away their pride. Jeremiah 13:9, it says, this is what the Lord says, this shows how I will rot away the pride of Judah and Jerusalem. Pride has always been a sin that man has struggled with, always. And sadly, we now have a pride month, a month in which we take pride in our sinfulness. Now, there's going to come a day when God's going to rot away that pride, just like he did for Judah. Do you know why God chose to rot away the pride of Judah? It says it right there in the text, Jeremiah 13:10. These wicked people refuse to listen to me. At the end of verse 11, after God has described Judah as the nation that he created to cling to him, a nation that should have brought him honor and glory, it says they chose not to do so because they would not listen to him. If you want to be the belt that clings to God, you got to listen to him. That was Judah's downfall. They wouldn't listen to God, nor would they listen to the prophet of God. Who do you listen to? Who do you listen to? Who gets the most attention from you? Answering that will, in part, determine the kind of belt that you are. Proverbs 2, verse 1, it says, my child, listen to what I say. Treasure my commands. Tune your ears to wisdom. Concentrate on understanding. Cry out for insight and ask for understanding. Search for them as you would for silver. Seek them like hidden treasures. Then you will understand what it means to fear the Lord, and you will gain knowledge of God. We need to be good listeners of God. Have you ever had a conversation with someone, but in your mind was so distracted, you could hear them speaking, but you didn't actually listen? Have you had the conversation like that? That happens to me. If I'm focused on something and one of the boys comes running in and they just immediately start to say something to me and I hear them talking. I hear them. They're saying something, but I'm not really listening because I'm just so focused. And I'll tell them, hold on, wait a second. First off, you got to enunciate your words. You're talking way too fast for this old guy. You slow down. I hear you, but I wasn't listening. Would you say it again? I wonder sometimes we don't treat God like that. You're at church, right? You're all sitting here. You hear the word being preached, right? You hear it. Everybody awake? You hear it? But are you listening? Judah was like that useless, rotten belt because they chose not to listen. Learn from their mistake. Be a useful belt. You can be a well-worn belt for all I care, but be a useful belt. Judah would eventually ignore God and his prophets so long that God just saw them as useless. May that never be said of us. Here's what happens, guys. If you leave your spiritual life unattended, you don't try to improve it, you don't try to grow, you don't try to read the word, you don't try to be consistent in being involved in a church, consistent in being involved in volunteering. If you leave your spiritual life just there, it's going to rot away like that belt. And pretty soon it becomes useless. If we water down the gospel to try and fit some narrative, to try and make the truth more palatable to certain people, we will become as useless as the belt. Being a useful belt, though, hear me, this is important. Being a useful belt is not about being perfect. You can't be perfect. Take it from a recovering perfectionist. You can't be perfect. And God knows that you can't be perfect. What he wants to know is, does he have your heart? Does he have all of your heart? Are you with all of your heart trying to cling to him, trying to do the things that he would want you to do? He wants you to cling to him like a belt. He wants to know that from the depths of your heart, you are following him and following his word. Not that you're going to be perfect, not that you aren't going to slip up from time to time, but he wants to know, does he have your heart? It talks about this in Deuteronomy chapter 8, this issue of the heart. And how the Israelites, of course, as they wandered the wilderness, it wasn't necessarily about God wanting them to be perfect. He wanted to know, do I have your heart? Deuteronomy 8:2, it says this, remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. See, he wants to know what's in your heart. That will determine how useful you can be in his kingdom. But here's the problem. Too many people, I feel like, want to know, what's the minimum requirement? What's the minimum requirement for me to make it to heaven? What's the minimum requirement for me to get some fire insurance so I don't go to hell? What's the minimum requirement for me to, like, volunteer? Like, how much is enough, but, you know, not so much that messes up my life. Folks, that doesn't work in the kingdom. I'm sorry. That's not a heart God can use in the kingdom. It's just not. He needs all of it. He needs you to be all in. Cling to the Lord, church. Be a useful belt. Paul used a very similar image when he wrote to Timothy. Instead of a belt, he uses this image of a utensil. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, here's what he says, starting in verse 20. In a wealthy home, some utensils are made of gold and silver. Some are made of wood and clay. The expensive utensils are used for special occasions, and the cheap ones are used for everyday use. If you keep yourself pure, you'll be a special utensil for honorable use. Your life will be clean, and you'll be ready for the master to use you for every good work. We understand this, right? When people come over, unless you're having like a cookout, right, you use the nice plate. Now, if you're having a cookout, you're still going to use like the nice paper plates, don't you? right? You don't use the cheap white ones, you know, the cheap white ones that you heat up your leftover pizza with. You use that yourselves, but, you know, typically you have some friends over or whatever. You get out the Chinette paper plates, right? And then that's what you have with. But some of you have that nice china. My mom does. Every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, she has to get it out, clean it first, because it's been sitting in the dust, right? And then we use it. Everybody uses it, and then you clean it, and you put it up. Why? Because it's a special occasion. It's the same thing, the utensil, the belt. You can be a useful utensil. You can be a useful belt. You simply need to cling to the Lord and then listen to him to be useful. And please don't think for a second, oh, I don't know how God could use me. And man, if you knew the stuff that I've done, Ross, or if you knew what was going on in my head sometimes. No, listen. He can use you. I want you to remember some things here. Hopefully this will help you understand how God can use you. I want you to remember some things. Noah was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Jacob was a liar. Leah was ugly. Joseph was abused. Moses had a stuttering problem. Gideon was afraid. Samson had long hair. That's not really a bad thing. Samson was a womanizer. Okay, that's what he was. Rahab was a prostitute. Jeremiah, they say he was too young. David had an affair, and he was a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Jonah ran from God. Naomi was a widow. John the Baptist ate bugs. God still used him. Peter, he denied Christ. The disciples fell asleep while they were praying. I'm sure none of you have ever done that. Martha worried about everything. Mary Magdalene, she was demon-possessed. Paul was too religious. Timothy had too many ulcers. And Zacchaeus was a wee little man, right? Like, Zacchaeus was too small. Lazarus was dead. Like, he can use anyone. Anyone. Doesn't matter where you're at. Doesn't matter what you've done. Doesn't matter your past. The future of your life for the kingdom can be so useful. But you have to cling to him. Just like a belt clings to our clothes. And you have to listen to his voice. If you do that, you will be incredibly useful for the kingdom. Father, we thank you so much for these images, both the one we see here predominantly just in Jeremiah, this belt, but even what Paul was trying to say to Timothy with the utensils. I think we get it. I hope we get it. I hope I explained it well enough. Would you allow us to just let that soak in today? And maybe even throughout the week, that every single one of us is useful. We can be. As useful as a belt that holds clothing tight, as useful as the utensils that we use on special occasions and not so special occasions. Lord, help us to be useful in your kingdom. Help us not to see ourselves as not good enough, not talented enough, but help us to just see ourselves as children of the King who wants to use us no matter what. And in the end, Lord, it's the heart. Lord, I'll take somebody whose heart is pure, whose heart is clinging to you over talent every day of the week. And so, Lord, I pray that you help us, all of us, to be as useful as we can be for you. I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to have now, as we normally do, our time of prayer, praise, and a time of decision. If one needed to be made, if somebody had a decision to either follow Christ this morning or maybe even just to join the church. But if you have a prayer request or praise, we'd love for you to come forward. Let us know what that is. Something too personal, remember, put on your connection card. Staff and I will pray about that. Those of you watching online with us, let us know what we can be praying for, and we'll certainly add you to our list. But if you are here in the building and you have a prayer request or praise, you can come forward now as we stand and sing. Guys can have a seat. Thank you for worshiping alongside us today. I do have a few prayer requests to mention. Dan and Sandra Redding, Dan called me yesterday and just wanted us to be praying for them. They got COVID, but they're doing fine. They are sick, but just be in prayer for them as they recover, and hopefully we'll be able to recover quickly. Jordan Hughes asked us to be praying for her grandmother who fell and got a pretty bad cut, and they weren't able to stitch it up just because of her skin is too thin. And so just pray that they're able to keep that clean, no infection. So be praying for her grandmother, if you would. Linda Kendrick, as we prayed for her for a while, she had breast cancer and has gone through all of that, but they recently found some nodules on her lymph nodes. They don't know that it's cancer or not. They will hopefully find out next week just what those may be. And so we're just going to pray that they're not, and she'll be able to continue to finish out the chemo and the radiation, and I think she'll be on some chemo for a while just as a maintenance. Also, Wayne Jones asked us to pray for Pauline's brother, so it would be Wayne's brother-in-law, Gambrel Chisholm. He has cancer, and there's nothing that they can do. They've called in the family to kind of say their last goodbyes. So be praying for the Chisholm family, if you would. And then Tom Norman will be having open heart surgery tomorrow. I'm going to do a couple of different things while they're there to try and get his heart back where it needs to be and get him back on his feet as soon as he can. But he's got to obey all the doctors. So that'll be important. Doing all those things as you recover is important. We've seen a lot of guys come through that and do really well with the rehab, and so we'll pray that that will be the case for you as well. And then just had a praise. Vinny, he had a couple of baptisms at his pool a few weeks ago. He called me to make sure he was saying the right words, and so I assured him that, you know, even if you screw that up, it'll be okay, but we talked on the phone a little bit, and then he sent me the video, a couple of folks that he'd been witnessing to for a while, and so he was able to baptize him in his pool a few weeks ago, so I'm proud of him for that, and we will hopefully be having a couple, maybe three, four baptisms here coming up in the next month or so that myself and April have been talking with a family, and so and we're looking forward to that as well. So those are things we can be praising God for or praying about, and don't forget, if you have physical offerings to give, to be sure and drop it off either side of the worship center. We appreciate that. Again, you can give online. You can give through our app as well. If you haven't already downloaded that, you can do that. Let me pray for us, and I'll let you guys go. Father, we come before you. We have some folks we just want to lay at your feet, many of them dealing with health issues. And so we ask that you watch over Dan and Sandra as they recover from COVID, help them to get back on their feet soon. Please allow Jordan's grandmother's arm and hand there to heal as best that it can, and it certainly that there wouldn't be any infection that would happen because of just how big it is and the open sore that it is. We pray, Lord, that Linda would get some good news here this week and that the nodules are not cancerous or anything like that. And so we've been praying a lot for her throughout this whole ordeal, and so we just hope that that is the case and pray that it will be. We want to lift up the Chisholm family as Granville looks like he's going to be with you here soon, and I just ask that you allow as many family members that can to be able to come around him and spend however many days left that you've given him, and that you'll be able to just allow him to pass away with dignity. But to do so in a way that would also just glorify you. And so we lift up that family to you. We also want to just ask that you watch over Tom as he has a surgery tomorrow. Guide all those doctors and nurses that will be alongside him as he goes through that open heart surgery. And we just pray that everything goes according to plan. Be a bit of a long surgery, but we just ask that you watch over him. And then in his recovery, that you do so as well. That he would stick to all the rehab plans and do what he's supposed to do there so that he can get back to full strength as soon as possible. And then we just praise you for a couple of people coming to know the Lord there in Vinny's pool. And I'm just incredibly proud of him and ask that you continue to work through him as he witnesses to those folks that he is able to come into contact with in the jobs that he works. And so we just are praising you for that. The two new people now know you and are following you, and so we're just very thankful for that. As we leave here today, Lord, would you remind us and help us not to forget that just like Judah, we are that belt. We're supposed to cling to you. We're supposed to hold tight to you, and we need to do that so that we can be useful. If there are folks here that just feel like they for whatever reason, they're not useful in the kingdom, allow your Holy Spirit to just move in their hearts to see even the list that I read of these people in the Bible and scriptures who were used by you and a lot of major issues. And we've got our own, but we know that you can use us, any one of us. So remind us of that this week, Lord. Help us to be that useful belt. Lord, we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys. Have a great week. Thank you.